Good morning, and welcome to WDRT. The show is called Conversations. My name is Dena Eakles, and my guest in the studio today is a Wisconsin native and a Vernon County homegrown gal. I'm happy to have Samantha Laskowski, a self-proclaimed energy geek, to talk about electricity and solar. I've come to know Samantha through our mutual interests in solar and in community-driven energy production. I'm thrilled that you agreed to this, Samantha.
I'm really glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me, Dena.
Yeah, I figure it gives me another chance to learn more and to hone my own practices of energy efficiency. So let's start from the beginning. Where did you grow up?
Well, I grew up about 40 miles east of Viroqua, right around Hillsboro, and went away to college, learned a few things here and there, got married, lived in Madison for a few years, which is where I actually first met you. Years ago, you gave a talk at the Willie Street Co-op,
that's right,
which I attended, and you know, I got involved in a lot of groups there that were talking about sense of place and deep ecology and what could we do to protect our environment more. And Len and I, my husband and I, actually participated in a group called Eco Teams, where we met with our neighbors and we looked at ways we could reduce our consumption and save energy. So that kind of got me started on a path. And I knew I always wanted to come back to Vernon County. So when, after many years of searching, we found the place that was right for us and opened a bed and breakfast.
Right. And that's in Lafarge for those folks.
Yes.
Give a shout out. You know, so much happens in Viroqua, so it's nice to give a shout out to the periphery.
Yes.
The Lafarge area.
Yeah.
Beautiful place. And yeah, what a wonderful beginning to, there's a lot of people in Madison who are working and trying to create community, and that's a great, great start. So, so with your opening, you installed solar panels and now you even have a battery system.
Yes.
You're really taking the deep dive.
We did. You know, we wanted to really make our bed and breakfast as green as possible and really walk the walk. So, you know, the bed and breakfast, organic towels, you know, our own produce from the garden, and our inspiration for this was Lisa Kivarist and John Ivanko in Browntown in Serendipity. And so we sort of modeled ourselves after that. But then, you know, the Badger Cooley line was going to possibly come through
where
this
we met
area.
Again.
Yes. And that was kind of how I kind of started going down this rabbit hole of energy and really became an energy geek, because I just really wanted to start understanding what we could do better and differently, and free ourselves from the possibility of, you know, these high voltage power lines coming through our beautiful area
that we have to pay for the next 60 years.
That's right.
But luckily we were able to, at least for this area, circumvent it.
Right. But things didn't stop there. Things don't stop there. Yeah. So yeah, and so when the flood of 2018 happened in Lafarge and Ontario and
everywhere
along the Kickapoo Valley, I realized I was surprised at the suffering that I felt for other people, even though we got by pretty easy. Mm-hmm. And that was when we decided that we really wanted the batteries. And we... Len and I and some other people joined together and helped to get batteries for the library in Lafarge, too, because we felt that was an important place for people to come and gather. And I've yet to meet anyone who doesn't believe that's not going to happen again.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Although we were talking about it earlier, a lot of people are still acting like it may not happen again, with the trees coming down and everything that's still happening in record pace.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, of course it's going to happen again. I mean, we are engaged in climate change, whether you believe, wherever you think it's come from.
That's right.
It's clearly happening.
Clearly.
So, and that was a feat to get Lafarge Library set up, self you know, completely self-sustaining that way.
It's nearly completely self-sustaining. And one thing that the library has that the Vernon County Energy District also does, which I'm also serving on the board of.
Yeah, I'm gonna, definitely want to get to that too more.
But we installed an energy monitor in their breaker panel. And so we're able to look at an app and see where the energy is being used. And what's interesting to me is that, you know, the library folks said they had LED bulbs installed, but a huge amount of their usage is lighting. And so maybe those aren't LED bulbs. So it does mean that we need to have a conversation about, you know, is that really what you want to stick with, or, you know, is it, is, are there some opportunities for some changes?
Correct. Yeah. Wow. So one of the things that you did and you're still part of, I believe, is the local energy generation, the LEG.
Yeah. So some local community members and I and my husband got together and created local energy generation. And we're just a group of loosely organized people, and we went to Westby Co-op Credit Union and worked with them to create the Leg Up Loan Program. And so about over a million dollars has been loaned out through that program. What people did is they invested their own money into non-interest-bearing savings accounts, which then gets re-loaned out. So a relatively small amount of money was able to create a big impact. And WCCU has been really supportive in that, too.
That's incredible. There's so much in this, you know, that people hopefully will be listening to and thinking more about. And I'd like to almost back up and talk about just the electric bills that we get.
Yeah.
Because I talk to people a lot about this, and I'm always surprised that they don't check and see how much kilowatt they're using or what peak hours are. Or so could you talk about that a little bit?
So the thing that really stands out to me is that by the time we get our electric bills, our electricity has already been used. We've already, you know, it's like, where did it go? What did I use it on? And that time gap makes it difficult for people to really have a good understanding of, you know, how am I using my electricity? How is my energy being used? And it becomes, from the utility perspective, it becomes a little bit more complex at that point, too. But people, because of that system, people just sort of like, well, I just pay my bill,
right,
and there you go.
Right, and the energy just comes magically to us, and then we just pay the bill.
Right.
And we've just really been engaged in this for a long time.
Right.
I know I didn't look at it for a long time, and now I look at it very carefully. You know, when am I using the most amount of energy? How can I reduce that? Even with solar panels that we have, I still want to be observant of that. Because, you know, where does our energy come from?
Well, so it's really interesting. So if you go on to the MISO, M-I-S-O website, you can see exactly where our energy is coming from and how much of it is coal and gas and solar and wind. And most of the utilities participate in the MISO market. And so they have to buy their energy from that market. And that's what makes up our energy. Now, of course, if you have solar on your own place, then obviously you know where your energy is coming from. And the key about the electric bills is that the trend, because there is going to be more renewables put into the system, there has to be. And what's going to happen is that the way the electric bills are designed is going to change. So it's going to become more important about when you use your electricity than how much you use.
Wow. Yeah, that'll be, for those who aren't paying any attention at all, there's going to be a gradual step up. Yeah, so I know I used to look at the there was a site, and I think it's still in operation, I Love Mountains. And it would, and if you would put in your zip code, it would tell you what mountains are coming down to produce coal for your energy. Mm-hmm. That was a real wake-up call mm-hmm. for me. Because mm-hmm. it was either, you know, happening out in Montana or Wyoming or West Virginia. And, you know, I do love mountains. So it was like, what can we do to slow this process down? Wow. Okay, then. So you did mention the Vernon County Energy District. Do you want to say more about what that is?
So the Vernon County Energy District was formed just a few years ago on Earth Day, and the mission of the organization is, in a nutshell, electrify, decarbonize. And how can we use our energy in a very thoughtful and efficient and effective way? So how can we decarbonize? How can we have more of our energy generated locally? Because $76 million in energy costs leave our county every year.
Now let's say that again.
$76 million.
Leaves? So that's from me paying my bill, Ed yes. paying his bill, yeah. you pay. That's the 76. So and everybody out there listening to this, yes. you're part of the 76.
That's wow. right. And it includes the gas in your car, the natural gas to heat your home, all of those energy costs. Okay. A sliver of that stays in the county, you know, to support the gas stations and so on. But that much leaves our county annually. Mm-hmm. And so the idea that we could have more of our own energy produced here and own it here and keep it in our own local economy, we think that would be important to people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, it's time. I mean, to stop paying out so much.
Right. And, you know, you mentioned the coal, the mountains mm-hmm. coming down. Mm-hmm. We don't have any mountains in Wisconsin, right. in the Driftless area in Vernon County that has coal or oil or natural gas, but we do have solar. And we have a little bit of wind. You know, up in Cashton, there are a couple of big wind turbines mm-hmm. that Organic Valley and Gunderson put up. Mm-hmm. But, you know, solar is kind of the thing that we have a great amount of. And if you look around Viroqua or any of the communities, there's a lot of solar real estate mm-hmm. on people's roofs. So there are a lot of opportunities available.
To go ahead and put solar up. And the prices are coming down.
Yes.
And there's things like your organization, LEG,
right.
to help out.
To help. And there is Green Penny in Decorah, Iowa. They are an online bank, and they solely loan only to renewable projects. So those are funding sources that are really helpful for people who want to move towards renewables.
So what do we say to the people who tell us that solar, that the sun will never do it, that there's not, the energy banks are not good enough, the batteries aren't good enough?
Well, I'll tell you that there is so much happening in batteries right now. It's really incredible. There's a company called Form Energy, and they make iron air batteries. They are going to be putting in their first battery system in Minnesota and Great River Energy. And they're going to test it there. And if that works, it could really be a game changer. It's based on the idea that the energy is stored and released through rusting and unrusting of iron.
Wow.
Yeah, so there's that. That's pretty incredible. There's so much happening even in the solar panels. Mm. There's solar panels that are made from telluride. I can't remember all the...
That's okay, we forgive yeah. you. So far, you've definitely committed to your right. energy geekdom.
Right.
So we're okay if you forget right. technical words.
So, but it's different than the typical solar panels that we have on our roofs. And they're flexible. They're the kind, and mm-hmm. you can create glass that you can see through, and they become solar panels. Right. So there is just so much happening in the technology area right now. It's really incredible. You know, the electrification of everything, the idea that the Ford F-150 Lightning is a vehicle to home, you know, battery storage. So you have an electric truck, and then if you get a power outage, you can use the energy you have stored in your battery on your truck to power your house.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's definitely a game changer for people out here especially.
Yes.
Wow, that's amazing stuff. So so how, again, does Vernon County Energy District play a part in this? Like, you know, can you explain it, how you are helping?
So the Energy District offers basically four services. So we have people who can do an energy assessment. So you can go on our website, vced.energy, and sign up to do an energy assessment. You fill out a questionnaire online, and you have a report generated to you that helps you look at ways that you can decarbonize and electrify. One of those ways is by installing a heat pump water heater. Mm. And it's incredible how much energy you can save just by doing that. Even if your old water heater is only a few years old, switching can save you so much money. Another service is energy audits, home energy audits. And Dave Ware has been working with us. He's a great, great guy, locally, very well known and well respected.
Homegrown.
Homegrown. And
we like that here.
We do. And so he comes and does blower door tests and infrared camera assessments and looking at where you have energy loss in your house. The third one
That's a really critical point.
It really
is. Because I just was talking to somebody yesterday who just bought a house / kind of cabin, and they're, you know, not very aware of how much energy seeps out of their house through their windows. And, you know, I mean, that's still something we could all be working towards more, to make our houses more insulated, not just throw the energy away, not just...
Let's just talk about that for a moment.
Yeah, let's, because it's important.
It really is. A few years ago, you know, we had air sealing and insulation done in our house when we bought it, a 1903 farmhouse. And, you know, I wasn't happy with some of the work that the contractors had done. And I went to a conference called Better Buildings, Better Business. And I learned some of the ways that contractors are being taught to do air sealing. So I decided to go into my own attic this summer and do air sealing, and pulling back the insulation, looking at all the penetrations through the attic, the electrical wires, the ductwork from the HVAC system, the plumbing, and it's incredible how much air has been going up through my attic and out the roof. And anytime I see black on the insulation, it's really incredible. That means that there's air infiltration and heat is being lost. So I am very methodically going through my own attic, a very dirty, hot job, but I am so proud of the work that I'm doing, and I feel like I'm becoming more committed to my own home, and I look forward to seeing how much more energy we're saving this winter.
So you are starting to you're starting to monitor that now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing, we to get closer to home, personally in our own homes, and then locally in our own homes, our own communities. That's really what you're talking about at the end of the day. So this is just a reminder that you're listening to WDRT's Conversations. I'm Dena Eakles, and my guest is Samantha Laskowski. And we're discussing the value of locally produced energy and all that we're facing with the climate change. So thank you. This is already very helpful information. I'm hoping people are enjoying. So how do they get in touch with, if people wanted to, we know how to get in touch with the energy district. How do they get in touch with the local energy generation if they wanted to do a project and if they needed help financially for that?
They just would contact WCCU directly. They mm-hmm. wouldn't have to contact...
The Westby Co-op Credit Union.
Yes, okay. That's right. And say that they are interested in funding a renewable project or an energy efficiency project and see what, you know, see if that fits their requirements mm-hmm. because they're going to do all of the credit checks and all of that. Mm-hmm. So local energy generation kind of provided the impetus to get this going, but WCCU is the one that carries it out.
Yeah, right. That's good. Mm-hmm. And that's great. That's a great service mm-hmm. that they're doing. I love that. It's getting back to energy, our own personal energy mm-hmm. usage, I think a lot of people are not aware that you can monitor through little devices.
Yep.
What are those called? I don't even remember.
So there is a little plug. It's called a smart plug.
There you go.
And
of course.
You plug it in, and, you know, years ago, we used the, what were they called? The kilowatt meters.
Mm.
And, you know, you plug it into your refrigerator, and it would tell you over time, you know, what is the average amount of electricity that it uses. Well, the smart meter does that, and it'll tell you through an app, but the smart plug will tell you through an app. But one thing that it can also do is it can turn that appliance on and off through your app. Mm-hmm. So if you have that plugged into a fan or an air conditioner or dehumidifier, whatever, and you're somewhere, you're like, I forgot to turn that off, mm-hmm. you can do that through your app.
If you have broadband.
Right, if you have broadband.
So a lot of people, I know myself included, still do not have that luxury. So we would be using, and that's what we did use, those little kilowatt things. And I think mm-hmm. they even have them at libraries mm-hmm. for people to borrow.
Yes.
And we found out we did it years ago, and there were a lot of children who loved toast, and we found out that we were spending $30 a month on toaster, on a toaster. So, again, little things like that, you know, hair dryers, you know, or even not using a clothesline, coming back to some really basic things that we can do to save ourselves money, but also help locally.
Yes. So one of the trends that is happening in the utility industry is moving away from this two-part rate system. When you look at your bill, you see your fixed charges, your monthly charge, and a lot of that goes towards administration and customer service and billing and that sort of thing. But then your kilowatt hours that you use is the second part. What utilities are now looking at doing is adding a third or even fourth component. So the third component is demand. And that means, so imagine that, you know, people start getting electric vehicles. They come home from work and, you know, a number of people in your neighborhood plug in at 5 or 6 o'clock at night. That's going to create a surge of demand. So the lines and the wires have to be designed so that it can accommodate that. And what it does is it can put stress on the system or require that more bigger lines get built to accommodate that. Mm. However, if you have your own solar, we have our own solar. If we use our solar when it's available and mm-hmm. charge our cars with that... Mm-hmm. that will be reducing the demand off of the system.
Right, and we can just look at what's happened in California and all these places now. I mean, you know, even I was hearing about Iraq the other day. I was listening to BBC, and they were talking about the temperatures going up to 127 degrees, and they have rolling electricity, so they have to shut it down. So even the people lucky enough to have air conditioning don't.
Right.
I mean, this is... potentially, and I saw that they were talking that a rollout in Wisconsin was possible. Hasn't happened, as far as I know. But again, it will pay us all to look more carefully at our usage and stuff.
At our usage, at making our homes more resilient by doing more air sealing and insulation.
Mm-hmm.
Someone once said to me, just to promote air sealing, he said, what is going to hold heat in better? A very tight, well-sealed tent or a very well-insulated, screened-in porch? And it's like, okay, you can insulate all you want, but like I said, that dirt, that black on that insulation is air coming through, and you're losing all that energy.
Mm-hmm.
So we really have to air seal and tighten up our homes, especially in our communities where we have a very old housing stock.
Correct, yeah.
So, but it goes to resilience, because the longer your home can retain the cool, the better off you're going to be to withstand if rolling blackouts do have to happen.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's the thing. We don't know what we're facing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as you said earlier in the show, the 2018 wake-up deluge of water that we had, you know, to think that won't happen again is
right.
Very foolish.
And let's talk for a moment about the heat dome that happened in the Pacific Northwest just last year, like year before. And those temperatures were like 118 degrees,
right.
And they don't have a lot of air conditioning out there either.
Right. Right.
So do we think that's not going to happen here?
Mm.
It was a high-pressure system that just kept that heat right there in place.
And we can go back to the high transmission lines in talking about that Pacific Coast, I believe it's the Pacific Coast line, that they believe actually the stray voltage from those sparked the fires, sparked many of the fires. I won't say they sparked all of them. We don't know that for sure, but significant amounts.
Yes.
So there's so much to be said to change our approach to energy.
Yes.
And it's time. And, you know, I know people don't like change. I get that. But really, a lot of what we're talking about, being more involved in a local community, that was all happening before. You know, it's only a few generations that we've become so dependent on things that we maybe shouldn't be so dependent on.
Right.
So, yeah, I hope, again, I really hope people are listening to this. I hope we're covering it in a way that, if nothing else, makes you more interested in your own personal homes. And also what's happening locally. I mean, that's such a great thing. I know Ontario, which we depend on for the post office and the library, you know, I would hate to see anything happen to those two facilities.
For sure.
You know, we need those facilities. Mm-hmm. I mean, most of us don't have broadband still, you know. This is nuts. But but this is the way it is. So, you know, that new Inflation Reduction Act that just passed, you mentioned heat pumps, and I don't think a lot of people necessarily know what those are.
So in Wisconsin, so a heat pump, I will explain to the best of my ability. It moves heat. It doesn't actually create heat. But so a heat pump water heater, let's say we're going to put one in our basement. It's going to take the heat in the air, and it's going to go through a compressor and compress that heat and put it into the hot water heater. And then your hot water heater will usually have the ability to use electricity if there's not enough heat in the air to heat the water. But changing to a heat pump water heater can save, compared to a regular resistance hot water heater, can save enough electricity to power an electric vehicle 10,000 miles every year. So it's really incredible what is possible. Now, heat pump mini splits or heating in your home is a little bit iffier in our particular climate. Mm. They continue to improve them so that they can work to temperatures quite a bit below zero and extract heat. But really, the ideal, I think, is around 40 or 50 degrees that, you know, it can extract heat most efficiently. But Europe has heat pumps all over the place, and I think they're doing quite well with them. So that is going to be one of the areas that's going to continue to evolve and as part of the electrification movement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was going to be my question, but you sort of answered it. How much energy do they take to run, and how expensive are they? I mean, roughly. I haven't checked into this at all.
I haven't checked into it recently either. I think they do tend to be a little bit more expensive. But if you're changing out your furnace, mm-hmm. it would do well to check into a heat pump. And there aren't a lot of installers yet in our area who are familiar with it. Mm-hmm. I think Flox in Cashton is pretty good. The other thing is that heat pumps can also cool in the summertime, they can serve a dual purpose. And you can save energy that way mm-hmm. and save money if you have to replace your furnace or your air conditioner to switch over to that.
So the reason I brought that up is that Inflation Reduction Act that I mentioned, which just passed the House and is going to be signed. I don't think it was signed yet by Biden, but one of the things is going to be a rebate on mm-hmm. things like heat pumps.
Yeah.
And $7,500 rebate on new electric vehicles. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's things that could help. Of course, you know, then there's always the question of mobility out here. Mm-hmm. You know, I did hear one discussion that was happening on the radio where people were saying, okay, it's really nice that people of money can go out and buy electric vehicles, but what we need is more mass transportation. Mm-hmm. Now, I know the other thing that's going to come up with this act is that all of the postal trucks are going to be run, or they're going to be switching over to electric. So clearly there's a movement that's mm-hmm. happening. Mm-hmm. But how will it affect us here? You know, how can we... That's why I always come back to, like, local, do it in your own home. You know, the Amish, they kind of had that, they were thinking about this stuff.
Yeah.
You know?
Electric vehicles, I think that there is this impression that they are vastly expensive and way beyond most people's reach. The Ford F-150 Lightning, when you compare it to a gas, an ICE is internal combustion engine, ICE, an ICE vehicle, it's really not that much more expensive. And the money you save in, you know, no oil changes and no transmission fluid and no exhaust system, you know, it's like, how often do you maintain your vacuum cleaner? You know, you just run it. Yeah, and so electric vehicles are a lot like that. So there's a savings in that way. And as far as, like, mass transportation, you know, it's tough because it's kind of like you have to coordinate all the people who want to do the same thing at the same time. If you live in Madison, it's easy because there are a lot of people who want to get downtown all mm-hmm. at the same time. Mm-hmm. Out here, it's a little more difficult. People being more willing to carpool and to, you know, take steps to kind of coordinate, I think that's part of what would be needed. And mm-hmm. maybe that goes back to more of a community building effort.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Yeah.
And if people aren't willing to do that, or just it's just not possible for them, then continuing to look at switching over to electric vehicles is going to be the way to go. Even though they may cost more up front, over the lifetime, they're going to be less expensive.
Not to mention health costs.
Right.
I mean, the exhausts, sometimes you get behind trucks out here and they're just spewing so much that I don't care to breathe. You know, one of the reasons I came out here was to heal from living across the street from an industrial park mm-hmm. as a youngster, you know? So, yeah, there's definitely that. The health costs are, they're real, you yeah. know? I know people, again, people don't want to change. They don't like it. They like the idea, you know, we're America. We've been built on, you know, fossil fuels. And what do you mean, reduce my carbon? You know, it's like we don't understand. But I always say to people, do you have children? Do you have grandchildren? You know, how do you want to, what kind of world do you want to leave them? You know, what kind of world?
Yes. And, you know, that really is one thing that motivates me. And other people aren't like that. You know, I was in Hillsborough this weekend and they were doing a tractor pull. And, you know, I grew up in Vernon County, so there is a certain thing that is quite compelling about the tractor pull. I understand that. And you were talking about, like, the black smoke just spewing everywhere. I cannot wait for the day when those are electric tractors that they're doing that with.
There you go.
And there are no emissions from that, and it becomes compelling. I mean, you keep your culture, but it's not the same thing anymore.
Well, I need to do a cartoon. I need to see a cartoon that shows that vision, because I had never thought of that. And I mean, we're touching on so many things, because now, you know, a lot of the tractors and things have moved away from people being able to care for them themselves.
Right.
Now you have John Deere, and you have to, you know, and again, you need broadband. You know, you need somebody to be able to communicate to your tractor in the middle of the field. You can't fix it anymore. You're not even allowed to fix it anymore in some cases.
Yeah.
So people need to, like, this has got to be a wake-up call.
Mm-hmm.
To, you know, how ridiculous we have allowed it to become, and how we can maintain our culture, as you said. I think that's a beautiful understanding that we need to all share and be excited about, not fight over.
Right.
You know, we don't need to. You know, what's it going to take? Another flood?
Right.
You know, is that going to, that's what's going to take?
Well, you know, the fourth service that the Vernon County Energy District offers is EV test drives. So we sponsored the a EV test drive event around Earth Day in April, and we have an electric car that we can offer people to take test drives in. And when people actually get in there and they take a drive, it's like, oh, this isn't really that bad. This isn't so scary. And wow, when you put that pedal down, this is actually kind of fun. It's kind of amazing. And so a lot of people have actually had a minor wake-up call in that way, where it's like, I don't have to be afraid of this.
Mm.
This is actually kind of nice.
Right. And thank you for doing that. And will you be doing it again anytime soon?
Yes, I think we're going to plan to do it annually. And
on Earth, around Earth Day.
Around Earth Day, yes.
I'll definitely want to help more people to know about it,
yeah.
so that they can have that, because this is really what we need. We need to help one another. And that's why I was hoping to do this show, and to give people a chance to, you know, it's a scary dive. You know, it's so much easier just turn on the electricity and pay the bill.
Right.
But when you start taking the whole calculation in, there's a lot to think about.
Well, let me tell you a little quick story. My husband and I met with some friends of ours who are from Texas, and they want to install solar on their home, but it's so overwhelming. And I think it's overwhelming to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things at the Energy District that we really believe in, is being able to be a resource to people and to offer information and answer questions and let people feel like you're not in this alone. You have somebody who can walk through this with you and give you advice, because we've done it. We've tried it. You know, we've got the solar panels. We got the batteries. We got people who have the heat pump water heaters. So we have firsthand experience, and we're going to tell you the best information that we have.
Right. That's wonderful to hear. I hope people are enjoying this morning's conversation. My name is Dena Eakles, and my guest is Samantha Laskowski. And we're discussing what we can all do to transition to more renewable energy. Just a reminder that you're listening to WDRT's Conversations. I'm Dena Eakles, and my guest is Samantha Laskowski. And we're discussing the value of locally produced energy as we face climate change. You know, I'd like to go back to something you talked about earlier, and that was how much money is extracted about from our county through our energy usage.
Yeah, so $76 million leaves our county in energy expenditures annually. And it includes your electricity, your gas, your natural gas. One of the things is that investor-owned utilities such as Xcel and Alliant, they are for-profit entities. And utilities are essentially a monopoly. So they do have this sense of extracting wealth from the community, and they're often owned or invested in by people who are not local in the community. So it's taking our wealth, our hard-earned dollars, and putting them in somebody else's pocket and making them money.
So I've understood that there are companies who are buying land in Vernon County to put up large arrays that we will be paying. So what you're saying is we're paying them as well as our electric company.
One of the things about those types of
third party,
right, is that you need a tax investor. Somebody, and it's a very narrow group of people who are capable of taking that tax credit, tax investment credit. So it's insurance companies, banks, certain C corps, people who have passive income, and that's not a lot of people in Vernon County. So those people who get that tax credit, they essentially take the benefit and run with it. And the idea is that it does reduce the cost of the array going up, but I want to talk about this one podcast I listened to fairly recently. It had as a guest Bill Nussey, and I can't remember the name of his book, but he has a book out. But one of the points that he made is that one of the things that is often stated is that these large arrays, these large power plants, solar power plants, are cheaper to build than it is for each individual person to put it on their house. And because it's like, I don't know, like a few cents per watt versus on your house, it's like double that. But the thing is that when those are put in, does your electric bill go down after those go in? And for most people, the answer is no.
Right.
Does it make money for the investor? Probably. Does it make money for the investor-owned utility? Probably. But when you put solar panels and storage on your own house, does that make your electric bill go down?
Absolutely.
Right. So it's really kind of taking a look at, you know, how do we look at the cost of putting these things in versus our own resilience versus owning it ourselves versus benefiting it from ourselves. And, you know, yeah, it does cost a lot of money up front. Now, the new
Inflation Reduction Act,
thank you, will give people a 30% tax credit again. And that'll be great. Because when we put our batteries in, the 30% tax credit was in place,
right,
and we took advantage of that. And so that will help. But the idea of owning it and benefiting from it in your on your own property for your own resilience, for your own self-insurance, when the weather changes and you need that, it's going to be there.
When the grid goes down.
And, you know, I don't know if the grid will eventually go down, but you know, if you look at the storms in the south, and they knock down those high voltage power lines, and people are out of power for weeks and months.
Right.
And when there's high heat, the substations and the power lines cannot withstand that.
Right.
So, I mean, the grid is not as resilient as it could be. And so for us to depend on that, we are taking a chance.
You're very kind. I'm not as kind as you about the grid, but 'cause I see the waste. You know, I see the waste, the stray voltage. When they put in a panel for the electricity coming to back to my cabin, oh, they said, don't worry, the trees are fine, everything's fine. The trees died. Oh. Everything that was near that panel died. Yeah, absolutely. That, you know, so there's a lot that we're, there's prices that we're paying that we don't even realize.
Right.
And that's why I mentioned the Amish, because, you know, at least they were like, no, we don't want to be controlled by these things. And I think that was wise. Now they can all have solar, and they don't have to worry about the high transmission lines.
Right.
I asked somebody one time, I said, why are you guys against the electricity? And they said, it's not the electricity, it's the lines that cross our property. And I was like, wow, that makes a lot of sense. But anyway, so yeah, I think that that's something to renew and restore in us, that feeling of community, you know, and that we're here together. I know the valley that I live in, that I hear that the people shared tractors, you know, they shared harvesting, they shared planting. That's not happening, you know, it's because people have their own private investment, you know, and then they can't, they either can't afford to loan it out, or they can't afford it in themselves. But what I hear you talking about is a lot of, you're very involved in service. You're doing it for yourself, which is good, because then you have a leg to stand on. You're talking from experience. But you're also doing it with a bigger vision. And I think that's a wonderful thing to restore again.
Absolutely. And, you know, me personally, one of my most favorite jobs in the whole world that I had was customer service. I worked for Schneider National in Green Bay years ago. And I loved the customer service because people came to me with problems and I could help them solve it. And so, you know, that's part of what drives me. But, you know, your point about the grid is, so I heard recently that the grid is only 43% efficient. So it is built to accommodate those infrequent circumstances that you need all of that to be built. And taking that off of that pressure, off the grid, and putting it into your own home, investing it into your own home, is going to help, you know, the wider grid,
yeah,
and also help yourself.
Right, and that's part again of that Inflation Reduction Act. A little bit that I learned, they're wanting to put in certain stations that will also take away from the surges on the grid, and they're talking about putting them in lower income places, which I think would be wonderful. I hope they do the same thing with broadband, but. Yeah, so people are thinking, and they are trying to make that step forward, you know, and then there's still a lot of talk about how we can't possibly ever leave fossil fuels behind, but I think more and more people are beginning to understand that that has to, we have to let go of that. And again, if for no other reason, just our own personal health and the health of the planet.
For sure, and you know, being able to change our behavior and use technology to help us change our behavior. I talked about the smart plugs.
Mm.
You know, we're really on the cusp of having technology that will help us control when energy is used in our homes. And that will help us reduce pressure from the grid if we're going to do that, or to take advantage of the solar that is being produced when it is being produced. And, you know, people who have an excess of solar, maybe batteries are going to get so cheap that you can move batteries around and be charged by people's excess solar and then move them around to places, and our need for poles and wires will be reduced or eliminated. Who knows? Who knows what the future holds?
Yes, I want to push back a little bit on your smart device.
Yes.
Because I can't have one. Not just because of that, but because I can't have one. That has forced me to be more conscious. Mm. And I think just flipping to a little gadget that's going to tell me everything might not be the way, at least I personally don't want to go. I want to understand. I really want to understand the intricacies of what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. Because I think a lot of us have, again, we've succumbed to this. Flip on a switch, there's the electricity. I don't know where it comes from, and I don't really care. I'll pay my bill when I can, if I can. And this is where we've come. I mean, it breaks my heart when I hear about people who cannot pay their electric bill. You know, that is like, what? You know, when we know we could rectify it. And part of it is education. And part of it is consciousness. Do we have to have every single light on in the house? Do we have to have TVs in every room? You know, really? I mean, is this the way we have to go? So I think that that is going to be a big part. And I hope we're not forced into it.
Right.
You know, I hope we can keep going on and adapting to this time.
You know, it's really an interesting point about the idea of choosing it or being forced into it. You know, the pandemic forced a lot of people into behaviors that they, you know, maybe some people thought, this is a good idea, but I'm too busy, I just don't have time. And then the pandemic forced us into certain behaviors. And, you know, to be able to choose, I'm going to do this, I'm going to move this forward because it is what is at the core of me. It's what I believe is the right thing to do, and not wait for those external forces. It's a lot of work. It takes a lot of effort, and but it's so important if people can just take a step in that direction.
Right. So it is so important, and I'd love to always think back to that first beginning time when the shutdown really happened during the pandemic, because absolutely the sky was clearer. The sky was bluer, there was less traffic, it was quieter. It was so different. The frequency was so different. And that can be accomplished, you know, and not necessarily impinge on our quote-unquote freedom. Mm-hmm. You know, we can still be able to be mobile and do a lot of things, but we won't be, interestingly enough, nuisances. You know, I had to look that up. Because of some things happening around me. But there is such a thing in Wisconsin now as a nuisance law, that because of things like the sand mining and the different things that were happening and they were impinging on, you know, because everybody says, well, it's your right. You have a right. You have a right. Well, you don't have a right to harm another person's well-being. It's called a nuisance. And that could be anything from noise, loud noise, to, you know, exhaust fumes, to anything. And I think we need to come back to that. We need to remember that. Because people, the only reason we have to have a nuisance law is because we have become nuisances. And again, we lost that sense of community and basic respect for another human being. So that's my hope in this transition. Because I can live very simply. I've demonstrated it to myself, and I'm happy to give people the opportunity to experience that. You know, I don't need smart gadgets, but I do need consciousness, you know? So this has been, I knew it would be a really great conversation and hopefully spiking a lot of people's interest in how can I learn more, what can I do? So that Vernon County Energy District, while they're going to tell you to get your little smart gadgets, and a lot of you are going to go, I don't even have broadband. But there's so much available through that if people are willing to just take the step and begin to, you know, look at it and the help that's available. Now, is that a nonprofit?
We are a nonprofit.
Oh, that's good.
We do not take any utility money. We have, and actually,
that's great.
There are a couple of things that I want to point out. So you can go to the Vernon County Energy District website, vced.energy, and take a look at all that we have to offer, the home energy assessments, and have your report generated. And if you want someone to come and have a one-on-one conversation with you about, you know, your own personal energy assessment, we're happy to do that. We also have a questionnaire that we would like people, a survey, I should say, a survey for energy planning, where you're asked questions about your utility, and you can give your opinion. So we'd like you to complete that if you haven't already, and then we will report those results comparing the different utilities publicly.
Mm-hmm. I think I tried to fill that out, and once again, not having broadband, I'm still not sure it really went through. I'm going to have to try it again. But yeah, this is good for people to really do take the deep dive that you've taken and begin it anyway. Okay, put your toe in the water and start to see what you can do differently.
Right.
What can you do?
You're not alone in this. We're happy to answer questions and walk through it and, you know, just be there with you and walk through this with you.
Great. So that's it, the Vernon County Energy District. And you kind of got that, that came from watching another energy district, right?
In Iowa. Right. Mm-hmm. They have a number of energy districts in Iowa. They do slightly different things than we do here. We've really focused on our four services.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's the way that we're going to continue to go.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good thing. So in these last couple of moments, is there anything more that we would really like people to consider?
You know, I think once you start on this journey, it'll be a good process. Just open your heart up and let yourself experience this as a good process, that you're doing what you need to do, whether it's saving money, you know, maybe for your kids' college education, or, you know, saving the planet and future generations. But it's a good thing to do.
And for those of you who don't believe in saving the planet, you can just put more money in your pocket.
Right, exactly.
But thank you for listening today. I hope this has been insightful and it helps you navigate the transition to solar and renewable energy. And I hope you follow up and check out Vernon County Energy District. And you can find this show on WDRT's website as a podcast. Please share it. Thank you, Sam. It's been great.
Thanks, Dena.